Beethoven, Ludwig van Beethoven. His name is synonymous with classical music. Beethoven's fifth, Beethoven's ninth, the Moonlight Sonata, the Pastoral Symphony, Feuerlies. There's an endless list of his famous and much loved works. Leafing through the concert pages of any daily newspaper, you'll see dozens of advertised programs for performances of Beethoven's work worldwide. That alone is proof of his enduring popularity and of the outstanding quality of his music. Beethoven was born in 1770 in Bonn. He was the son of a musician, a choirmaster, who, by all accounts, divided his time equally between the church and the local pub. He was quick to recognize his son's prodigious talent for music, however, and encouraged him to study. By the time Beethoven was 17, he was living in Vienna and working as a professional musician, playing violin in theater orchestras and, of course, the piano, at which he was highly accomplished. Beethoven's brilliance of the keyboard, particularly his extemporizations, brought him to the attention of several notable people in Vienna. These people, including Haydn and Mozart, were to have a great influence over him. Beethoven was already in very good company. By the age of 30, Beethoven was firmly established as one of Europe's leading musicians. And then, with everything going well for him, tragedy struck. He realized that he was slowly going deaf. Imagine a blind Picasso, a mute Pavarotti. His personality apparently took a turn for the worse too. His performing career was over. From now on, he concentrated solely on composition.
Beethoven's formative years were spent in Bonn, at that time still a small rural town. His early years spent here in this family house were not happy ones. Fortunately for the young man, he was saved from obscurity when his precocious talent was recognized by court organist C.G. Niefer. Niefer took Beethoven under his wing and was to have a great influence on the young man. Even more influential than his relationship with Niefer were his meetings with Haydn and Mozart, shown here at the age of 25. By the time this piece, the famous Pastoral Symphony, was written in the summer of 1808, Beethoven had found his own muse. The inspiration is entirely unique to Beethoven. The shackles of formality have been cast aside. The symphony is not, of course, a literal depiction of the countryside. It's a monumental tone poem celebrating the embrace of the natural world. The romantic movement was to be characterized by the search for the means to express emotion. Beethoven was at the forefront of that movement. In this work, we hear a composer who is no longer restricted by form and precision. In the Pastoral Symphony, we witness the complete transition from the classical tradition to the fully fledged romantic movement. The life of Beethoven was to be inextricably linked to the Emperor Napoleon. Their paths crossed many times, one a genius on the battlefield, the other in the concert hall. Initially, Beethoven had been a great admirer of Napoleon. He respected the revolutionary zeal and the common touch of the man who was known as the First Consul. Beethoven had intended to dedicate his Third Symphony to Napoleon. But hearing that his hero had crowned himself emperor by his own hand, he flew into a rage. Napoleon, man of the people, was no more. Napoleon the tyrant had arrived. The symphony, which might have been the Napoleon, is known as the Eroica. The altered title page with Napoleon's name scribbled out still survives. Despite the fact that Beethoven's Third Symphony does not bear Napoleon's name, posterity has linked this piano concerto to the emperor. The Emperor Concerto was written against a backdrop of carnage wrought by the man now associated with it. Described by Einstein as the apotheosis of the military concept, the concerto reflects the splendor of martial power in the Napoleonic era. Beethoven wrote the concerto, his fifth and last, in the midst of the bombardment of Vienna by the army of Napoleon. The composer took refuge in his brother's cellar, where he covered his ears with pillows to protect his failing hearing from the noise of the cannons. It's not too fanciful to imagine that the grand main theme, the explosive quality of the cadenza, and the conflicting dialogue between the piano and orchestra owe much to the circumstances of its composition. The fates which brought Napoleon and Beethoven together also provided the inspiration for this, his most famous work. Full of menace, the four-note theme has been compared to the hand of fate knocking at the door. Although the work is now universally popular, initial critical reaction was poor. It was not until the critic Hoffmann heard the symphony in 1810 that its true genius began to be appreciated. Beethoven's music opens the floodgates of awe, fear, horror, suffering, and arouses that endless longing which is the quintessence of romanticism. Your reviewer remains convinced that with this present symphony, unfolds Beethoven's romanticism more fully than any other of his works. In a climax which continues to mount until the very end, the listener is transported into the marvelous spirit realm of the infinite.
Quarrelsome, fickle, and miserly, Beethoven was a fairly dour character, though not lacking in wit. He wasn't short of money either, living quite comfortably on the income generated by the publication and sale of his works. He remained a bachelor, although he was greatly admired by and attracted to women, and was frequently in love. Beethoven's approach to composition was totally different to that of Mozart, for instance. While Mozart would dash off a symphony before supper time and then go out for a game of billiards, Beethoven chose, or was forced, to pursue a much more painstaking method. He wrote his ideas in a series of notebooks, altered, added to them or crossed them out until he was satisfied. Only then would he finally sit down to compose. However painful this process was, a work would often germinate and flourish in the notebooks for a period of years. The effect of spontaneity is as fully achieved as it is in the work of Mozart, indeed in the work of any composer who ever lived. During the middle period of Beethoven's life, say from 1803 to 1816, his music displays a new boldness and energy. His only opera, Fidelio, dates from this time, as do the Eroica Symphony and the Fifth and Sixth Symphonies. After this, his music became brooding and more introverted, but no less expressive and finely crafted. Although Beethoven had spent almost half of his life wrestling with the awful problem of his increasing deafness, which was to become total, he produced during the last few years the Missa Solemnis and his magnificent choral symphony, the Ninth. The late string quartets and piano sonatas are truly exploratory. He stretched the boundaries of expression through tonality to the very limit. He was the last great classicist and the first real romantic.
Desperately unlucky in love, Beethoven was still seeking a wife when he was into his 40s. In 1810, he was consumed with passion for Teresa Malfatti and set out to win her affections. He smartened up his usually scruffy appearance and even bought new clothes. Sadly, Teresa did not return his affection. He was to remain a reluctant bachelor. The Moonlight Sonata was composed in 1801. Beethoven dedicated it to the Countess Giulietta Guicciardi. Beethoven had fallen in love with the 17-year-old and proposed marriage. Guicciardi's father, however, opposed the marriage, and she married a nobleman instead. Beethoven was inconsolable. But his despair did inspire this great romantic work. Full of yearning and a sense of infinite space, the forlorn quality of the long hanging notes, seemingly suspended in space, reminded Rellstab of moonlight rippling on the waters of Lake Lucerne. It was he who gave it its popular title. The precision of the construction perfectly evokes the unfulfilled yearnings for lost love and tenderness experienced by its composer. The notes seem to hang in a huge void of emptiness. This magnificent symphony was written against the backdrop of a changing world. The Industrial Revolution was gathering pace, and by the 1820s, the first steam locomotives were already running. Grim factories and industrialization were beginning to blight the green places Beethoven loved so much. If the world was becoming an uglier place, then so was Beethoven's increasingly rude manner. Goethe knew Beethoven and remarked on his moods. "Never before have I seen an artist with more power of concentration, more energy, more inventiveness. Unfortunately, he is an utterly untamed personality. He does not make it any more enjoyable for himself or others by his attitude." The awkward nature of the composer could not be more at odds with the magnificent beauty of this work. Beethoven wrote the Ninth Symphony between 1822 and 1824, possibly because of the keen financial interest he took in the organization of the concerts. Beethoven has left comparatively little choral work. What he did produce is without equal. This, the last movement of the Ninth Symphony, is widely harked as the single most complete work for choir and orchestra. Beethoven demonstrates an absolute mastery of the dynamic possibilities and the forces at his disposal. The power of the work comes from a theme of unparalleled beauty and a dynamic use of rhythm and contrast. Alternating between passages of serene calm and allegro flights of passionate intensity, the overall effect is to leave the listener breathless. Beethoven was, by this stage of his career, pushing at the very barriers of melodic writing. After the Ninth, there was nowhere left to go. In later years, only Tchaikovsky could even hope to approach Beethoven's grasp of melody.
Beethoven died in March 1827 and was buried with great honors in Vienna at a funeral attended by no less than 20,000 people. Fittingly, Schubert, the rising star in Vienna at the time, was one of his pallbearers. I do hope you found this brief introduction to the world of Beethoven and his music enjoyable and rewarding. Music, you know, is a seamless and constant art. So join us again for another journey into the mind and art of a great musical maestro.
Yeah.